Okay, great. We are live.
Yeah, nice.
Okay. Hello. So nice to have you here, Stan. Stan from Scale, a very interesting solution for scaling Ethereum that now we see that is really, really loaded with many appliances and many transactions. So, first of all, Stan, I would like to ask you, what's your role and what's the history of the Scale team?
Yeah, that's a pretty interesting story. So I'm the CTO, so I can tell you a little about myself. I'm pretty much very typical nerd. So I was studying physics for a long time. I was actually a scientist. So I did the PhD in physics in Germany at Max Planck Institute. And then I moved to America. I was at Los Alamos National Lab. It's a federal lab in New Mexico in the States. And then I moved from New Mexico, I moved to California. So I was a researcher in physics at Stanford University. And then, you know, as many people, I moved to like startups. So the first startup I joined, I took a course at Stanford in cryptography. And the professor was actually a well-known guy. His name is Dan Bonet. And he's a crypto professor. So I took a course from him and I got A+ from this course. And then he was forming a startup in doing crypto. So I just joined the startup as an engineer.
Yeah.
And pretty much like since that time, all of my life was in crypto. So I joined the startup. The startup ended up raising about $50 million. We were doing a hardware encryption for databases. So encrypting all kinds of sensitive data in databases. And then after the startup, I started a security lab, and this security lab was working with American government on all kinds of security analysis and penetration testing and things. So I've been working for this lab for several years. Then I started a Wi-Fi security startup. And actually for that one, I got back to Ukraine because as you mentioned before we started the broadcast, Ukraine was really inexpensive in terms of engineers. So actually for this Wi-Fi startup, I hired people in Ukraine and we did this Wi-Fi thing. We ended up installing in many famous places like London, Thames River, New York City, the former telephone buses in New York City, San Francisco public Wi-Fi, San Jose public Wi-Fi. So we're doing all kinds of public Wi-Fi in many different places. And then we were acquired, this startup was acquired by a telecom company in London. So after this startup was acquired, I started a startup which was doing big data because at that time, everyone was like big data, AI. So we got money from VCs for a startup which was doing big data AI. And we were developing the startup for about like a year. And then, you know, we actually coded the platform. The platform was there, but it was really hard to sell the product because at the same time, Google actually also had a similar solution and AWS had a similar solution. So you're like, why do you want to use like a small startup if Google has something like that? So we actually wanted to like push the startup somewhere, like get acquired or acquired. Actually, we almost got acquired by a large company in Oregon. But at the same time, all of this Ethereum craze started happening. And I frankly didn't know anything about Ethereum. I knew about Bitcoin, but Bitcoin I didn't really like for whatever reason. So I knew about, and then our VCs, we had two venture capital firms, Signia Ventures and Floodgate Capital, and they pretty much told us, don't go and like just, you know, acquihire, actually go and learn about Ethereum because you know big data, maybe you can apply big data in Ethereum. So I literally like jump on the airplane and I didn't even have a ticket for DIFCON. So one of our VCs gave me like a badge and I went to DIFCON 3 in Cancun in Mexico.
Yeah.
And it was like crazy. I think like the moment I entered this place, I realized it's like a great moment. It's like, you know, I remember like the first time I used like a web browser or the first time I saw like an iPhone. there are some moments in technology where you suddenly see this thing is going to be huge. And I just like literally entered this conference, and I just saw this people were like, Vitalik were like, they was like dancing on the stage, and people were like celebrating, and some people had lots of money. So it was like crazy environment. And I was so excited. I thought, okay, even if the VCs don't give me money, I will still stay in this because I really like the atmosphere and the fun and everything. So actually I went back to California, and then VCs gave us a little bit money to research things. And then I met my co-founder, Jack, who was at the same time in parallel also studying crypto, and he was doing crypto investing. And so we kind of got together, and Jack is the CEO and I'm the CTO. And literally for 6 months, we're like researching what to do. And one thing which we totally understood from the beginning, that Ethereum was like unstoppable bulldozer, that there was so much momentum and excitement and community. Mm-hmm. It was like, this can't be stopped. There's no point, because some people said, okay, let's create an Ethereum killer or something like that competes with it. And I said, no, we're not going to do this, because it's like death sentence. You know, there's so much real momentum inside. So we started to look how we can help Ethereum, you know, what we can do to actually make it run faster. And we came up with like pretty much like a series of iterations. We came up with an idea of a parallel network, like a GPU for a CPU. Essentially, you know, you plug in a GPU and it starts working faster. So we came up with this parallel network. And then there was, for about like 6 months, we researched technology and we got more money from the VCs, and all of these things like kept on iterating. But finally, we came up with, I think, pretty simple solution, which is it's a decentralized competitor to AWS. It's a network which can be potentially of a monster size. So it could be millions of computers. We understand it may take us like 20 years to get there, but the vision is to have these millions of computers and have thousands or tens of thousands of blockchains, all of them ETH compatible. So then ETH mainnet is like the security foundation, but you also have this much faster chains. And together, you can pretty much take any website like Uber or like Airbnb or Facebook and move it to this network. So essentially, it's very much like what people say, it's like internet of blockchains. So every server becomes a blockchain. The only thing which we are totally like unique about is that we want to be ETH compatible. We're not creating any new language. Well, if you can program Ethereum, you can program us. We just run much faster, and there's much more computational capacity in this network. So that's pretty much the idea.
The idea and I for example, this year I went with a friend of mine to Stanford. I didn't have the opportunity to meet Bonet, but I remember when I studied, I think 5 or 6 years ago, you know, the bilinear pairing cryptography and also the Skira, the BLS for short signatures, I used for an app for BLE, so Bluetooth low energy. I need short signatures or a way to realize an identity PKI that was very efficient, and I can. You know, I mean, you get for free with beginner pairing all this. You can have an algebra for signatures. So the sum of signatures is already signatures. Absolutely. And stuff like that. Yeah.
That's fantastic. That's actually, it's a funny thing, because then Bonet invented this in around 2000 and didn't really get much use. There was a startup, then actually started another startup, which was called Voltage Security, but it didn't get so much traction. So they were trying to like commercialize this in identity-based encryption and signatures, but it wasn't so popular. But with blockchain, suddenly this aggregate signatures and threshold signatures become really
it's the basis it's the basis of a roll-up. When I saw the roll-up, I say, I'm already using, thanks to the, I remember the schema BLS 0103. I don't remember, but
And you know, the funniest thing about this, the funniest thing is that actually this thing, this mathematics, which is pretty like crazy complex mathematics called Weyl pairing, it was actually invented by a French guy. His name was André Weyl, and he invented this in jail. He was jailed for, in prison. He was in prison for avoiding draft during the war. And so they put him into prison and he had nothing to do. So for 2 years, he just had a piece of paper and he like invented this pairing, which had totally no use. I don't think he ever thought that would be ever commercially usable, which I think proves like, you know, the fundamental science. You never know when it's going to get usable, maybe 100 years, maybe 10 years. But at some point, suddenly these dots are connected and
We could spend hours to discuss about this also because the history of physics, you know, also has a nice history. I come from a physics background.
Oh, nice. That's fantastic. Yes. So physicists are smart because physicists are actually mathematicians try to solve problems which are solvable. Physicists are trying to solve problems which are unsolvable. So actually, physicists are doing usually much better in startups because in startups, you're trying to do something which is like, how am I going to do this? Or like, you know, physicists tend to be great when they move to business because physics per se is a science where there's no guarantee of any result. Or like, oh, everything is approximate. You know, physics is approximate. Math is
That's true. Okay, so getting to the main rail right now. So you say that the startup was with just you and your CEO, and now how many you are in the company?
Yeah. So that's a great question. So the question actually comes to the point that how many people you want to have in a startup. Well, usually, you know, many startups have a problem when they have too much money. They hire too many people and they just grow very big and can fail. And this is especially true for blockchain because blockchain is very complex. And if you're building a complex system, you don't want to have too many people. You want to have very few smart people. So we were like paranoidly trying not to hire people. And altogether, we have, I think, about like 25 or 30 people, but all of the people are really unique. And we really like put like paranoid, you know, attention into trying to find extraordinary people or people who are really interested in startups, because not everybody wants a startup. Startup is a very specific thing. So we, in Ukraine, we hired a lot of people with mathematics background and also that physics. And this is actually also differentiates us because we think blockchain is not really just coding. It's not like programming. It has much more of a scientific thing. So I think that many other teams are more like coming from programming background. And our guys, in many cases, come from mathematics background, people who are interested in science. So I think that's something which differentiates us. And in San Francisco, we have a really great business team. For instance, Marcos, who is also present at this call. He was working in many famous companies such as Unity. So we have like, I would say in San Francisco, we have a very much typical startup guys and girls, while in Ukraine, it's more like very young guys who are like math and science competition winners. And I think it's important to have people who like startups because actually, if you look at Silicon Valley, you can make lots of money if you work for Google or Facebook or whatever. I don't really have to go to startup. In fact, actually nowadays, many people in Silicon Valley prefer to go for Google or like Facebook. So people who actually keep on working at startups are different. They're more like have this nerd mentality. They're interested in trying something interesting. And I think blockchain is really intellectually is a super exciting place. If you don't money or if you don't make money, but it's one thing, but intellectually it's so many interesting people. Sometimes people don't agree. Sometimes they, you know, fight, but it's very live space, I think. Very, very live and exciting.
That's real. I agree with you. So We know, I mean, this is the moment for layer two solution because the Ethereum network is clogged. We see the limits of the network, the limit of the choice that was done before. We are looking for, you know, the EIP 1559 for having a better bidding mechanism for fees. So we saw many layer two solutions, and many users ask us, okay, what's the difference between, for example, a Loop Ring or the guys from Matter Labs that just went live today with ZK Sync, and with solutions like, for example, Starkware that was adopted by Diversify, for example, giving a new spike for the original ETH Phoenix DEX. So how, where scale put itself in this scenario, in this ecosystem, and what's are the differences, both the pros and the cons of the scale solution, what we can build on top of scale?
That's a fantastic question. And I'm going to start with an interesting story. So first of all, I'm going to tell you that we are blockchain maximalists. We're not Bitcoin maximalists, or we like Ethereum, but we are blockchain maximalists. And I'm going to explain in a simple words, because that's really the key thing. What does it mean to be a blockchain maximalist? You know, I think there's probably like a great mathematical theorem. I don't have the proof for it. I have just the conjecture. Maybe if I were a professor, I would prove it, but I need like 5 years. But I have a conjecture. It's like the great conjecture. And the great conjecture is like, it's like this. Whatever, if you have a decentralized solution and you start improving it, you always arrive at blockchain. And let me give you an example. Let's say you are an ancient man, right? You don't know what a sphere is. You don't know mathematics. So you don't know what a sphere is. But what you have like a stone, right? And you're like trying to roll the stone. And what you find out, they're trying to improve it. So, and then you're kind of trying to cut here, cut there. You know, the stone starts with some shape, and then you keep on improving the shape. And then what's going to happen that you might not know what the sphere is, but in the process of you improving the stone, you will arrive at the sphere because the spherical stone rolls the best, right? So the best rolling stone is the sphere, and you will just experimentally arrive at the notion of the sphere even if you didn't have it. In a very similar way, what we believe on, there is this conjecture that when you start with a decentralized solution, any like ZK rollups, Plasma, this, that, you know, and you start improving it, you will arrive at the blockchain. And what is a blockchain? In the blockchain, you always have parties, right? You have, it's decentralized. So you have by default more than one guy, right? Or girl, right? So it's decentralized. You have parties. And in a blockchain, parties are all symmetric. Like if 10 of us run the blockchain, we all have the same role and the same power. And that's why it's decentralized. And let's say there is a solution where I have more power than you. Then it's going to get more decentralized if I shift this power to you too. So it's kind of, I'm not saying it's a proof, but it's, you probably kind of get a feeling that the best decentralized solution is a solution where every single party is symmetric. So I'll leave you with this, you know, this is a conjecture, but that's the conjecture which we believe in. So we believe is that the perfect decentralized solution is a blockchain. Now, if you look at a solution which are not blockchain, like ZK rollups, Plasma, all of these guys, we're not those guys. They are different in the sense that they come from a different point of view. They say, okay, here's the operator, the guy or the girl, and the guy is the guy, right? And then other people have a different role. They just like cops, they like police. They watch this guy, and if the guy is misbehaving, they complain on him or punish him, or they fire him and hire another guy. But the solution is asymmetric in terms of the parties. The guy has more power, and the cops have different power. So that's the basic difference between us and not another solutions. Blockchain, we are purely blockchain, and these guys are not blockchain purely. So what it leads to is that, let's say you have a solution where there's a single operator and other people are watching, you can complain to if your funds are stolen. It's kind of easy to find out if the guy steals your funds, you complain and they give money back to you, right? What is very, very hard to do, what's very hard to do is to protect against manipulation or front running. Let's say the guy runs your crypto exchange, right? And the guy doesn't steal any money. He just uses the information to do the trades. Things like front running or manipulation. You know, like I run the exchange, you trade, you found some great trading idea, you're sending me a transaction, and I take your transaction and I insert my similar transaction, the copy, in front of yours. That's what is called front running. It's a very generic thing based on the use of information. If I get your information, I can trade like you. So because of that, we believe that solutions that are asymmetric, like the ones you mentioned, are not well protected against front running and all kinds of manipulation and stuff. And for DeFi, front running is the most important thing. You know, there is some research that people are like making zillions of dollars on all kinds of front running, right? Like all the super smart traders doing the things. Well, but these guys don't have so much power. But if you are a roll-up operator, or if you are a plasma operator or whatever, imagine how much power you have. People send the trades to you, right? It becomes a huge, huge incentive for you to start doing these things. That's why we believe, you know, and I think ultimately, solutions like rollups may be used in cases where it doesn't really matter. Front running doesn't matter. If I pay for coffee, maybe front running doesn't matter. If I know you actually just paid for coffee, fine. You know, how can I use this information? Not much, right? So in some cases, front running payments, for instance, front running doesn't matter. But for DeFi, where front running matters, we think this is a fundamental problem. And blockchain actually solved this problem. Actually, the problem solves completely using two things. One thing is a blockchain. First of all, you have to have a blockchain where everyone is symmetric. You have 100 guys that run this proof of stake blockchain. But then there's actually what we found out, there is a cryptographic technique which almost fully solves the problem of front running. This technique is called threshold encryption. It's actually similar to threshold signatures. And the way you can totally solve front running using threshold encryption is when the guy submits a transaction to a blockchain, the transaction is first included into the blockchain, encrypted. And then only after that, the nodes work to decrypt it. So by the time this transaction is decrypted, it's already in the blockchain. I don't want to spend too much going into mess, there is a mathematical way to using a blockchain and threshold encryption. There is a very strong, mathematically provable way to do an exchanges without front running, or with greatly diminished front running. So to summarize the story, I think another way to look at this is that we know that many people do different types of experimentation, like ZK rollups, and these are great people. You know, ZK stuff, like ZK Starks, all of the things are great. Actually, there are some ways you can use them. You can use them for privacy. You can use them for random number generation. We actually might use them at scale. But I think the difference that what we are trying to do, we're trying to be like a startup. And not just experiment, but ask a question. Is the customer going to use it? If the customer even suspects front running, is the customer going to use this solution, which is more centralized? So that's why, we're purely blockchain maximalist. And that's very, we believe that mainstream world will run on blockchains. Maybe there will be niche things for all kinds of other mathematics, but that's what we bet our company is bet on, our project is bet on two principles. One principle, we strongly believe that Ethereum is a bulldozer. So we even think 3 years before, 3 years ago, it was impossible to compete with. Now it's even You can't really compete with it. So we believe the Ethereum is the bulldozer and it will win. That's really a point. We totally believe in that. And number two, we are blockchain guys. And I can tell you a little more in the future, but we spend lots of time researching blockchains. And so we have our own blockchain consensus, which is very much based on academia. Very, very good, well, and my modular consensus that's based on academia work.
Yeah,
I'm talking too much, I know.
No problem. Better too much than less. I will interrupt you, but we are covering all the questions. So the fact to have a some sort of hidden mempool to protect the front running, or anyway to be able to hide transaction in some sense, but it's quite interesting. It's one of the first times that I heard about it. So one of the questions related to from our users to comparing you from a very high level point of view is that they saw you as, you know, in the classes of having some sort of little blockchains, side chains that communicate each other in some sense. So the question that arises, how much is big this number and how they communicate each other. And in this sense, I will add a question that is essential for DeFi and will be a challenge too when if it will be live Ethereum too. So how you can preserve, if you can, the composability and the atomicity when you basically, how to say, let interact, if you let interact, maybe entities that belongs to several points.
Yeah, that's a great question. I'll start with kind of another story. So when I was like a boy, a child, I read this science fiction story. It was from a Polish science fiction writer. His name is Stanislaw Lem. And he wrote many interesting stories, but this one is called Invincible. And the story is about like a spaceship. So the spaceship comes to a planet. And on the planet, there is a war. And there are two types of computers fighting. One is like a huge, huge, huge computer, like supercomputers and like huge computers. And another like tiny computers, but they are very flexible and they're able to assemble into networks. So whatever, like if they see this huge guy, they can assemble in a particular network. And the network fights. And because it's a network, it's very resilient. It can, some of them can die, right? If this guy like starts like killing them with lasers, some of the smaller guys die, but because it's a network, it reroutes and it still fights. So which shows that the decentralized architecture, it's much more resilient than a centralized architecture. To give you another example, if you look like at sci-fi movies in like 60s, like Star Trek, people thought that computers would be like a huge, huge, like a supercomputer, right? If you even watch like the Terminator movie, if you remember, like the Skynet was like a one single computer. So people thought computers would be like Cray. But in fact, what turned out that architectures where computers are decentralized, many small computers connected, they won. And that's why internet also won, because internet is a set of loosely coupled computers that are very resilient, because if one router fails, it reroutes through another route. So we see, so I think from the history, if we learn from the history, it's very clear that the architecture that is going to win is going to be not a strongly coupled architecture, but a loosely coupled architecture. And that's what we are trying to build at scale. We want to build an architecture with many blockchains, all of them secure. And then we need to actually just enable communications from blockchain A to blockchain B. So we actually did this. We already, actually, if anyone wants to try, it's already running. And it's all implemented fully ETH compatible in a programming language called Solidity. You don't need to know anything except Solidity to send these communications. You can have two blockchains and you can send any secure message from one to another. So you can actually call a smart contract on blockchain A to a smart contract on blockchain B using Solidity. So all of our developers, we have already doing hackathons. Many people already tried this. We had many hackathons. We had about 40 applications in the pipeline, I think. And so this stuff has been fully implemented, super simple. Literally, it's like smart contract A sends a message to smart contract B. And it's the message is guaranteed to be delivered, and it sends the Solidity. And then once you have this lower layer, on top of this low layer, you can build anything you want. You can build all kinds of protocols, all kinds of complex things. We built, just using our stuff in Solidity, we built token transfers, because a token transfer just means that you freeze a token on one chain and you print it on another chain. It's like, give you another example. Let's say you want to send money from Italy to America. Well, you could have a machine, you would just stick like, you know, 10 euro in this machine in Italy, and then it would print it in America, and it would all work if the communication is secure. If the communication is not secure, you could actually be printing too much money in America because the machine in Italy would not be saying the truth. The security is super important for this kind of a token transfer. And we built it, all of this built in Solidity. And anyone can come up with any other token transfer and build it on our network, because in our network, the very basic mechanism is just to send message from point A to point B. Very much like on internet, the only thing which IP knows, internet protocol, you send a message from a point A and point B, and all of the other stuff like Facebook, whatever, is actually at the lower level, this protocol, this
packages. Yeah, it's an exchange of messages.
Right.
Of packages.
Very much the same stuff. We have this protocol in Solidity that sends the package, and then everything else is just derivation. So we have this, and so this is super important. We call it interchain message transfer. And we also have another thing, we extended Ethereum virtual machine to provide also file storage, because we want people to be able to do like Facebook, to be able to store photos, images, and stuff. But this is a super important question you ask. And so the ultimate answer is that all you need to build a new world is many loosely coupled blockchains, and you need to have a minimum thing to send a message from blockchain A to blockchain B, and that's enough. Everything else can be built on top of this as applications, like it happened for internet. So that's why I'm very excited about this particular architecture, because it's very similar. It's very similar to internet.
I see. So reaching to the question more related to the to the businesses or to the main left launch that will be at the end of this month. Mm-hmm. I would like to ask, this is the aggregator challenge that basically do for any layer two or in general scaling solution on top of Ethereum. Mm-hmm. So suppose that we want to have Uniswap, or we want to have 1inch, for instance, or Paraswap, an aggregator that would like to, aggregate liquidity that may be on Ethereum or on scale. So what are the challenges that he or she may have on analyzing this? Because price discovery could be difficult in this sense, if, the money is one place or in another place. So how do you expect that these platforms will opt for a specific scaling solution or interact with?
Yeah, that's a great question. I understand that, people will need to get used to the fact there is not a single chain, ETH chain, but many chains. But unfortunately, it is unavoidable. A single chain cannot like hold the entire world. So maybe we wanted to have like everything on a single chain, but if we want to compete with Google, we want to compete with Facebook, we want to have decentralized like Uber, we need to have computational power. So we need to have more than one blockchain. So it's a complication, unfortunate one, but necessary. And in the old world, people are used to having many servers. it does create a complication. You don't have just a single server, but you have to communicate somehow with many servers, but people are used to it. So what's going to happen is that it does include a bit of a complication, because now you have many blockchains and you have to think whether you do different operations. Very much the same if you're like building a Facebook, you have like lots of servers. Okay, many people think how this thing operates, but unfortunately it's unavoidable. But what's going to help, the helping thing is that there will be several things. First of all, there will be frameworks that will hide this. I told you about the framework we have for token transfers. So you will just be able to seamlessly transfer tokens between the different chains. And we hope that there will be much more, that code will be reusable. And we hope that people will create open source solutions to simplify this thing. But if you do, but one thing which is super important, one thing which we need for success is these chains that we create will be as secure as ETH2. So it's not like this thing is going to be less secure, so you temporarily send stuff to it and then you have to go back.
Yeah.
We are building it as secure as ETH2. It's going to have the same validators as ETH2. Our consensus algorithms are very similar then as to ETH2. They're mathematically provable. So there's not so much different between scale chains and ETH2 shards in terms of details, you know. So it's going to be as much secure, which means that you won't have to care about like constantly sending it back and forth between the mainnet and these chains. What you will need to do though is start thinking in terms of distributed architectures, that you have more than one computer, but the world needs like decentralized Google. I made some poll on Twitter and people like asked like Google, Uber, you know, Airbnb, which one you want more like decentralized? Most of people said decentralized Google. People want control search. They don't want Google to tell them what they find, right? I can tell you this interesting story. Like years ago, I was at a business meeting at Stanford and Sergey Brin, the founder or co-founder of Google, was there. And you could just approach him and ask questions. And a question which I asked, it's like really interesting. Many years ago, I said, you know, are you scared that at some point open source solution may actually compete with Google? And he said, his answer was no, because open source guys don't have the resources. That was literally what he said. Right. So with crypto, we actually like closing this loop or connecting the dots in a sense that we have open source didn't have money. Crypto, the way I see this, it's a way for open source to actually get financing. So we have crypto and open source. And if we glue the things together, we finally are able to do things like, you know, competitor to Google or competitor to Uber. Like I'm taking like taxis all the time and the taxi drivers are really not happy about Uber because Uber takes like 30% of money. And, you know, 30% is more than 30 because they have to pay for the car and the gas and the repairs and everything. So people with decentralized Uber, the taxi drivers will be able to get 100%. So their salary will go up twice. So that's why these decentralized solutions are really, they're not like vitamins, they're aspirin, you know. They may change the economy around the world a lot because suddenly you don't have the monopolistic power, you know. Open source guys create something and they make some money, but then leave. You don't have huge companies like Google or Facebook. They have like streams of money and zillions and they control everything. They control like the entire world. They like, if you look at Google, you see things like people like in Latin America or in Africa or in Italy search, Google makes lots of money. They don't pay taxes in Italy or they don't pay taxes in Africa or they don't pay taxes in Latin America. So you have all of this stuff. And so people around the world are really, really want, it's a very significant desire of people to try different economic forms, which are more just. And I think with this, we need to be able to do it now, not just 5 years from now. So the scale, you'll be able to try doing decentralized Google this year, right? You can try doing decentralized Uber the moment scale releases. And that's what we are really excited about. And also with all kinds of DeFi applications like crowdsourced lending, micro lending, I think we're really interested in all of these things succeeding.
Yeah, thanks for the extensive explanation. Now we just move to the more money related questions. So we know that you expect to have a token, so the Scale token. So the questions that you already answered, that you were backed by investors, so you get money for building this solution. But you have this token. So we would like to understand how works this token and what's the tokenomics of all the system in this sense. So what's the role of the Scale token?
That's a great question. And first of all, Scale, as every other project, I think, Scale, we're building Scale for many, many years. We understand, it took like many years to aid for Amazon, for AWS to get successful. So it's a startup. What we're releasing now is like our Tesla Roadster, but we have like Tesla Model S and Tesla Model 3, but it will take us many years to build. But the token is a very interesting question. The question is actually, first, how do we price things? So what happens is that in our network, people put their computers, their servers in the network, right? They validate, right? But then other people come and from this network of computers, they buy blockchains, right? What we sell, what the network sells is blockchains. The question is, what's the price? How to determine the price? And we're actually using the algorithm, which is exactly the same that you mentioned at the beginning. I think the one which is used by Ethereum. How do you dynamically and in a just way determine the price? Well, let me give you the story so you understand how it works. Let's say you have office space in San Francisco. Sometimes people pay more money for offices. Sometimes they pay less money, less rent. The question is, how the price is determined, right? There are actually studies which show when the occupancy rate in San Francisco goes above 90%, the prices start going up. And when the occupancy rate goes below 90%, the office rents go down. And occupancy means that what's the percentage of occupied offices versus like unoccupied, right? Mm-hmm. So the same idea is used in TH2. You probably know Vitalik suggested this, and we adopted this idea, but we actually adopted this before ETH2 because our network is a little earlier, like comes earlier. So the idea is dynamic pricing. We say in our network, let's say the optimum load of our network is 80%, meaning that 80% of computing power is doing something and 20% is idle. We do need to have some idle things, otherwise the network cannot accept new blockchains. So we set 80%. And then what the algorithm does every day, if the occupancy rate is below 80%, it increases the price, it decreases the price a little bit. So more people buy, right? If the occupancy rate is above 80%, it increases the price, so there's more incentive for validators, for computers to join. So it forms this dynamic balance where it kind of controls the price, and the long term, what's happening is that the network is growing, but the occupancy rate actually kind of fluctuates a little bit around this 80%, because 80% is the equilibrium.
The steady state.
And that's super interesting. We never tried it. It's all theoretical. No one in the history of humankind ever tried it.
We'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. Actually, frankly, to be frank, totally, when we start, the first couple of two or three months, we're just giving people a Slack, meaning that it's going to be just super cheap. We're not even switching this algorithm. It's going to be almost free. I think it's not for our early participants. So this is like first two or three months of like the manual thing, but then we'll switch the algorithm on. And in theory, it sounds fantastic.
It should work, yeah.
We'll see. We have one of our guys coded this algorithm, so it has been coded. There's still so many parameters. How fast you change the price? It will be super interesting to see this. I think Vitalik was great in coming up with this algorithm. I think he did like lots of visionary things. I even mentioned on Twitter once that Vitalik should get a Nobel Prize because he did like some really interesting things in economics. You know, he invented the Turing complete smart contracts, and he did lots of other things. And I think this pricing mechanism, it was also a great contribution from him. Okay, we actually ended up using it faster than ETH2. But now let me give you another very important thing. When you have this dynamic pricing, what is the hope is that the validators, they make money, right? And then they have some costs. So they can run on AWS, they can run on their own servers, they can buy some refurbished servers. So the validators have an incentive because the income is fixed and the incentive to lower the cost. So what we hope to see is that validators inventing different ways to lower the cost. For instance, there are so many in data centers around the world, there are so many servers which are just black, dark, you know, like Google has so many, all of the telecoms have these dark servers which are just over capacity. So they could run scale, right? So what we hope to see is that people starting to get much more inventive, how to run scale in a cheaper way. And then when this happens, the price can go down further. Now you see that this economic difference between us and AWS. AWS has absolutely no incentive to lower the price, right? So with a decentralized network, because you get fixed income, you get an incentive to innovate. So it becomes a much more innovative environment, and the innovating party wins versus just the guy, the monopolistic power of AWS. So we understand that when we initially start, the guys will probably run on AWS, but maybe as they learn, they realize they can just hire a server, or they can buy a refurbished server, or maybe they can talk to some guys in the data center. And if this starts to happen, the hope is that our Tesla Model 3, that we create a source of computational power that is much more innovative, and it's blockchain, so it's resilient, it's secure, it's decentralized. So this new decentralized AWS will be actually much better, much more innovative, and much more inclusive. And that's kind of the Tesla Model 3 vision, which may take 20 years. Because initially, I'm pretty sure everyone's going to run on AWS. But, you know, as things progress, people will learn.
Yeah, clear.
No, it's interesting. I mean, it's... In some sense, it's competitive to ETH2, okay. Your solution.
Please.
The way we see ETH2 is, and that's an important, really important thing about kind of this world is brands. You know, I think we can be in cooperation with ETH2 and we can benefit them. ETH2 will always be the foundation of networks like ours. Our network, we have so many smart contracts on ETH1, actually. All of our node management, we currently have the largest ever set of smart contracts ever deployed on ETH. When we deploy our mainnet, we deploy it on the testnet now. When we deploy on the mainnet, it's gonna cost us over $1,000 of gas fees. We have so many contracts on the mainnet. So our token lives on the mainnet. All of our validators nodes are on the mainnet. Our bounties are paid on the mainnet. So we have so much stuff happening on the mainnet that, you know, we think that that's the way it's gonna progress, that ETH mainnet, ETH1, ETH2 will always be a security foundation for everything. But, you know, if we want to compete with Amazon or Google, even 64 shards is not enough. You know, ETH2 is going to have 64 shards, and it's going to be a great improvement for the foundation. But, you know, if we want to have a bolder goal, you really like go into millions of computers. I think Google now has about 10 million computers, I've heard, and the same similar numbers about AWS. So if we want to really compete with Google, is 10 million computers. Is 10 million computers a lot? Not really. I mean, we have 6 billion people in the world, right? If everyone puts a computer, it's like 6 billion computers. So it's actually people saying maybe it's crazy to compete with Google, you know, but we do need to have a much more scalable network, which not just 64 shards, like, you know, 1,000 transactions. But this ETH2 will always stay, I think, the foundation because of the brand. People, this is such a strong brand that the way it may evolve, ETH2 will be the foundation. Then there will be networks like ours. There's other networks, like there is like networks for backups, like Arweave. There are people doing like analytics, like Graph. There's like ecosystem for ETH nowadays. It's not only ETH, but several projects.
I was about to say it's on the market that was arising.
And we do compete with roll-up guys a little bit, but I think the way we think about this is that probably everyone will get some peace, you know. So, you know, they're great guys, you know. The great thing about ETH is that all of the people are very nice and honest and decent people. So it's a bit of a competition, but overall we are like friends, I think.
It's a very good community.
Yeah, and I'm so excited, you know. I was so lucky, really. You know, actually, I've been doing like startups for a long time, and this proves the point that startups, the most important thing is timing. You know, people think that, you know, I've been doing so many startups in the past, and it's usually like you try, you fail, you know, it's pretty hard, you know, thing. But sometimes you do it like long enough, you just get the right moment. And as I told you, when I just joined Ethereum in Cancun, I realized it was the right spot to do things. Yeah. And I think it's still the right spot. I think DeFi is a fantastic place. And also all kinds of this year, even Vitalik, I think, tweeted about this recently, all kinds of decentralized applications going mainstream. So it's a pretty good time, I think, to join.
Yeah, I think too. In addition, it's the first real use case for ETH. And about your launch in mainnet, because you did a launch in the testnet, you launched the testnet 1 month ago, and now in 12 days, you are going to launch the mainnet. So what we are going to expect for the launch of the mainnet? Which application we will see on your net? Which are the references to see those applications, maybe a registry or something like that? And for the builders in our community, which are the incentives to maybe replicate or building something new on top of scale?
That's a great idea. And, you know, which brings to another subject. I think what's going to happen about all of those networks like ours, we have, I think Marcos can tell me, I think like about like 50 people, 50 validators joined our program. And so we have great interest in people becoming validators. And we have like 40 DApps in the pipeline. But what's happening with all of the systems when I was doing physics, actually, this funny thing, I was at the Institute for Physics of Complex Systems. So there are like simple systems and complex systems. And that's a big difference. A simple system, you can always like perfect. You have like, you know, like a knife and you like perfect, it's a perfect knife. While it's a complex system, like a smartphone, there's so many interactions inside, it's impossible to perfect. There's always bugs and stuff. So complex systems have different laws from simple systems. And one of the things is that people actually play a much more important role. So when we start, the important thing for us is going to be forming a community of our validators and users. For Bitcoin, for simple things like Bitcoin, it may be not important. You know, validators may be just anonymous people, not ever interacting. But if you have a complex thing like scale is first and foremost is a community of people. Yeah, they run computers, but it's a big fish formed by small fish. It's probably going to be small businesses all around the world or small validators. And they will form a competitor to AWS. And they will be democracy and all pluses and minuses related to democracy. We'll need to find the compromises and common direction and things. So literally we're starting like almost like a country. And so this network is great to start, the production network, but it's just the very beginning. So when we start, we'll first start on R. We have one validator, which is closely related to scale. And then we will let several validators, more and more validators. So there will be a gradual launch because people will need to learn, and we can't expect people to create a perfect network from the beginning. It's just the start of a road. So people will be learning. And actually, once we start, we'll be actually shifting into this learning experience. We need to create like this democracy and essentially a university where people can actually start doing things. So it's going to be a process. It's not going to be just one single start and everything is perfect. You know, and it's a complex system. We expect the like a bumpy road initially, probably, but we understand this. We don't really even assume it's going to be easy, you know, but it's going to be super interesting. So I think we'll start the network. There will be some initial number of validators. And then as we see the network being stable, we'll let more people in. And then at some point we'll let anyone in. Although there are some ideas, like we may say, if you want to become a validator, you need to let 5 other validators to approve you. So it's like a decentralized system, but still we want the community to be in some sense controlling who gets in. Because decentralization and permissionless doesn't mean that you should let in bad guys. If we create a cooperative with you, like to sell Italian pizza in Ukraine, there could be like a cooperative, like a million businesses here in Ukraine, but we still, it's a cooperative. We can set our rules and we can differentiate good guys from bad guys. So being permissionless, that doesn't mean that just let anyone, it means that the community decides whom to let in. There's no centralized authority. It's decided by community. And I think that we'll have to understand how we do this too. So even I think the community part is going to be more important than the technology. Because if we don't have the community, if we don't create the right set of people, technology is not going to help us because the system is complex. Bitcoin is simple. So it just runs, anyone can do. Our stuff is more complex. So we do need, in addition to machines, we also need to understand how we find consensus of people. And it's unavoidable, I think. So it's going to be a super interesting ride. And I invite everyone listening to this podcast to join us in this thing.
Yeah.
No, it's pretty much. I think that many of us will follow the launch, and probably because these trends of, you know, joining and be part of, you know, of a network, of an ecosystem is something that people are willing to do. I think that we will see people that want to be a validator or want to join this ecosystem. To be honest, I think that we will have two classes of people in this sense. So the ones that just want to participate staking something, for instance, to just lending money to the effective validator, and the one that maybe want to be autonomous in this sense. So I think that we will see this. Okay, so I'm approaching to the last question of today, because you don't know, maybe it will be also tomorrow. I mean, not tomorrow, but the next time. So. You arrived to the mainnet launch with a specific set of features that are the ones that we discussed so far. So after that, after the growth plan of more validators, more appliances, what are we seeing in the protocol or in the network in the future? So what's the roadmap for scale?
Well, that's fantastic. That's a fantastic question, because, you know, that's actually, we have like discussions inside scale. And sometimes people say, why are you talking about this? It will happen far in the future. And I'm like, you know, I think people like want to see things happening in the future. Like Elon Musk, he was talking about Tesla Model 3 like for 20 years, and it actually got successful. So I think people are okay waiting. So we have the long-term plan. So this is like our Tesla model, Tesla Roadster. Sometime next year, maybe at the end of this year, but probably more like next year, we'll release our like Tesla Model S. which is going to have two things. First of all, it's going to have AI, machine learning, just the prediction part. The reason why we need AI is for things like, if we want to have a decentralized Facebook, we need to be able to have image analysis algorithms. For instance, if someone uploads something to the social network, you should be able, the blockchain should be able to say, you know, is this a good image or bad image? Maybe it's an insulting image. So this type of things. So because of this, we need to have neural networks. And so we're putting all of the Google TensorFlow, the entire TensorFlow on blockchain, and it's going to be a be part of EVM, of Ethereum EVM, the extension. So you'll be able to use all kinds of neural networks for all kinds of interesting ideas. People actually, during hackathons, had lots of interesting ideas about AI and blockchain. That's number one. Number two is private transactions, meaning that when you like buy coffee, some people don't want to, other people to know that they bought coffee. So they will have private transactions using SGX, which is a reasonably secure technology, and it's going to be secure from the commercial point of view. Probably you wouldn't put a super, super secret information, but the fact that you paid for coffee, it's fine to be inside SGX. So we'll have private transactions and AI, but then our Tesla Model 3 is actually something which we call App Store. It's like Apple App Store. What you realize is that we are a tiny group of people and we don't want to grow. So we can't really code much. We don't want to code everything. And we'll just keep on improving the kernel of the thing. And then we really want to give all things to community. So it's going to be a decentralized app store. And then everyone will be able to contribute. And we'll say specifically that we won't do anything except the score, because we don't want to compete with our community. Mm-hmm. Like Linus Torvalds, you know, he's coding kernel, and he's been like coding kernel, and he doesn't even know how to like do UI. He only programs in C, right? The same for us. We'll just want to keep the kernel and improving the kernel and make it super, super secure and stable. We do need these private transactions and AI because these things are critical. Another thing which we are kind of adding, we're gonna add a deterministic version of Python. So you'll be able to also, in addition to Solidity, to also do like super simple Python scripts. And it's important for things like mathematics or AI, because Solidity is very limited from the point of mathematics. So we'll add Python and you'll be able to do a simple Python script. And also if you have a Python script, you'll be able to do like a website and everything. So this addition of Python will be a subset of Python, will be another thing. And then after that, the point is that we don't want to compete with our community in any way. So we hope to transform into more like a distribution like Linux, where we actually, there may be many distributions of scale. And when you create your blockchain, you may be able to say which distribution you want. And you know, we don't want to have any control on that. We just want to concentrate on the kernel of the thing and let everything else, you know, all of the totally take away all of the other things and move them to community. So that's the great idea. But we do need more people joining us and our open source project. And if anyone wants to join us in any way, just help a little bit. We have some bounties and things. Mm. We have some budget for even small things. If you find a problem in documentation or if you find a small bugs, we're not asking for much. If anyone wants to just contribute a little, there's so many things, little things could be done in our GitHub. Everything is on GitHub. You know, we have bounties. You can put in your resume. So I strongly encourage anyone who wants to help us to just PM me, and then we'll find some small things for you to do.
It's a very ambitious plan, and it should be ambitious in this sense. So not so many times I heard about startups that has so many ambitious plan, and in some sense realizing this, because you know the launch is imminent, and we will see. I mean, it will need time, obviously, but we will see for sure at the very beginning if it's going to work, or I think not, but yeah, it won't work.
Thank you, and I think you know, open source has this quality, open source is much more like survivable. If we fail at scale, someone else can take our source code.
Absolutely. So
it's actually, you know, it's actually much better survivable than like proprietary startup. Yeah. They fail. Yeah. In our open source, actually, it's very good thing for, because people take the code, they can reuse it, they can tweak it, they try something else. And so everyone is welcome to also take our code and see how it works.
I agree perfectly. Also, because, you know, as you mentioned before, the time is important. Maybe now is not the time. After 5 years, you get back the code. You obviously upgrade that, and you will have success. Anyway, I think that we have closed. I just checked it right now if we have any other questions from the community. So, as we do usually, our last question. My last question is, Stan, do you have any question for me, for the DeFi Italy community? So this is the question.
Actually, I have a question. The question which I have is, DeFi Italy, we really want at scale to know what is going on in Italy in terms of DeFi. So is there any website? What's the best source to learn about things which are happening in Italy, you know, in DeFi space?
Actually, there is no, official DeFi Italy website, but probably it will be. The point of reference is the Telegram group where you are in, and also the YouTube channel where we are streaming this.
That's fantastic. So I'll be in the Telegram group. If anyone wants to chat me, I will be always in the Telegram group. I'll try to participate too as much as I can.
Yeah. And if they have any specific question that maybe need to be elaborated in English or whatever, or maybe
I can translate using Google Translate.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so I think that we have finished. Thank you,
Emiliano. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Let me just block the streaming.
Okay,
that's good.
That's fantastic.